So here we are, reminiscing about the old days. Yearbooks. Mm-hmm. So this one that you have over here, yes. Sandra.
Yes.
This is 70. Tomlinson.
The last.
This is the last yearbook from Tomlinson High School, and this is our senior year from King Street.
Senior high.
So that's what we're talking about.
It was 1964 when I met Anetta Jenkins, and we would develop a friendship that would span more than 50 years. We met in the fourth grade while attending Anderson Elementary, the only elementary school for black children in King Street, South Carolina, the county seat of Williamsburg County. On May 1st, 2021, we reunited in our hometown of King Street to share our talents. Inetta, a TV producer and host of her own show, and I, a retired educator and author. We met at the African American Museum for a live taping and book signing for my new book titled The Imperfect Storm, Racism and a Pandemic Collide in America, How It Impacted Public Education and How to Fix It. We discussed several aspects of my book, as well as reminisced about our experiences of being the first class to integrate King Street Senior High School in 1970. During our visit in King Street, it became painfully obvious how much had changed in our beloved town. Booming businesses were now closed or torn down. The high school we attended, Tomlinson, was destroyed with only remnants of what it once was. And most recently, Williamsburg County school system had unfortunately been taken over by the state. What was happening to King Street? That became the burning question. So, Inetta and I decided to search for answers, which became the catalyst for this documentary. What happened to the King's Tree? Join us on this breathtaking journey as we discover and rediscover our time. Growing up in King Street, the tracks, as it was affectionately called, did more than just run through the town. It was symbolic of another form of what separated us, economically, politically, educationally. We've seen businesses come and go. We've seen our education system rise and fall. And the political power, well, we asked some of the locals about their thoughts on the matter. And here's what some of them had to say.
Okay, basically, I went to Tomlinson, W. Madison Elementary School, then up to Tomlinson High School. I'm a graduate of the class of 1967. Mm-hmm. I was a class president both junior and senior year. Mm-hmm. Played football, went to South Carolina State, had a good stay there. Then I came, left South Carolina State and went up to Columbia, stayed in Columbia. Then my parents started, you know, getting older and needed the help, so I decided to move back to Florence. Mm-hmm. And basically, I'm an entrepreneur because, you know, with this business and the other area I grew up in is up the track. My grandmother had a convenience store there, so, you know, I know about them two for a penny cookies and maybe.
Mr. Harold Thomas of King Street, South Carolina. He's a resident here, been here over 60 years. And we're gonna hear his opinion on what is wrong with King Street, what happened to King Street, and how does he think it should be fixed?
That's a good question, how to fix it.
Speak up.
I said, that's a good question. How to fix it now?
Okay.
And that, wow.
What do you think happened? What do you think happened to Kingster?
I think that guy said, wow. Joe, what happened to King Street? Wow. What happened to King Street? The wrong people got in office.
You know that all the time.
Okay.
Government in King Street is what happened to King Street.
Government.
Yeah. The government.
Yeah. Okay.
Like
okay.
Who people we put in office.
Okay.
Right.
I can tell you in a few words. What
okay.
Happened.
Tell us.
The big fish eating up the little.
The big fish eating up the little fish.
That's well,
exactly. Yeah, this is where we are right now. So, and then. Go.
There are many areas here. We would need to kind of sum this up. Because you could spend all day really talking about any one of these reasons that we don't have jobs here or there or over there. The point is, I stated it, it's through our representation. It's through who we send to Columbia and to Washington to represent us in government. Bottom line, everything is political. It's dealing with politics. Keep in mind that the state of South Carolina is a Republican state. It's not a Democratic state. Williamsburg County votes Democrat. But the state itself is a Republican state. So then, why should we expect a whole lot from a Republican governor if the government is not working together hand in hand? Now, you know, I can take you, we could talk about this for a long time if you want to. I take you out on any limb when we're speaking about Republican and Democrat, because I've lived under both and been represented through both. Some of them are good and some are not. We had many Democratic governors and many Republican governors. But keep in mind, the last time that the state of South Carolina was a Democratic state was a long time ago. Now, if you want to study up a little bit on history and talk with me, that would be fine.
That would be fine, absolutely.
Government all over the place, not just here in Williamsburg County. I would prescribe that the supervisor that I succeeded or that I took over from, I believe he had a lot of challenges. And then I know because I sat in county council meetings and I heard those challenges that he faced. Although it gets to a point sometimes in a leader, if you are not really strong enough or you don't see people pulling enough for themselves, you get discouraged. And I do believe that that's probably a place where he was at. So when I took up the reign, of course, I was met with all kind of things that people probably would have left the first year. Given the state of the county's budget was never balanced for years prior to me taking office.
So may I ask your predecessor, how long had he been
he
at
He had
that
two
office?
Terms, 8 years.
8 years, mm-hmm. Okay.
Three, four-year terms. So naturally, I guess people at some point give up. Mm-hmm. So they kind of just let it run the way it's going to run. Mm-hmm. So I inherited an even larger mess, in which, again, came into the county government and we had did not have a balanced budget at all, which meant that we were overrun in our funding. Mm-hmm. A lot of things were done at the end of the old administration that placed us in even more of a financial detriment. My first budget in 2019, it was a literal fight because I couldn't get members of council at that time to understand the decisions that they made yesterday was impacting what is happening now. Mm-hmm. And if we don't do something, then we're going to fail. Mm-hmm. I presented members of council with 15 options for the budget, 15 different options to correct our budget deficiencies.
Okay.
We did not get the budget passed for months after the deadline. We ended up having to do a resolution, a continued resolution, because by law, by June 30th, we must have a balanced mm-hmm. budget in place. So we've worked through that. Again, a lot of other issues came up, stuff that, you know, funding, money, that just, you know, how did you set this up and how are we gonna pay for it? And so now, of things, and we're able to do a little bit more in the county. Do I wish we were further along? I do.
Mm-hmm.
But we still have a lot of old thinking is what's preventing, in my opinion,
uh-huh.
this county from moving to the next level.
Other government officials we reached out to included Congressman Jim Clyburn, State Senator Ronnie Saab, and Representative Caesar McKnight. We did receive a call from Congressman Clyburn's office and spoke at length with his constituent services coordinator, Mr. John H. Rickenbacker. However, we were unable to coordinate a time to interview the congressman. Senator Saab nor Representative McKnight have responded to our request for an interview.
Like, what do you do with that?
Well, council members work with the supervisor and making decisions, suggestions, whatever, for the citizens.
Okay. Okay. And how often do the council meet?
Twice a month.
Twice a month. Okay. So, I've been driving around the town. I was here a couple of months ago. My friend and I, Dr. Ionetta Jenkins, we started riding around and looking at our county that we grew up in, went to school, and in fact, we just finished driving by Anderson Elementary School, where we went to elementary school, and then Tomlinson High, where we went, and it's so many things has changed from when we grew up. So I guess part of my concern and questions are, what happened in King Street?
That's a good question. Well, most of the young people leave.
Why do you think they leave?
Well, there are no jobs.
No jobs? Why aren't there any jobs?
Because we don't have any industry. Industry does not come to Williamsburg County.
But it used to.
Very few. Yes, it did. It used to. And hopefully it will again. But right now, it's not here.
What will it take to encourage industry and economic development to come back into this town?
I do not know. I mean, really, if we do have industry, a lot of the people will live in other places like Florence, Lake City, you know, because, well, according to some of the people, it's because the educational system is not up to where they want it to be for their children.
Okay. So everything comes back down to education.
Right.
So that makes sense.
This is Ionetta Fulton, and we are here in King Street, South Carolina, talking with the Williamsburg County School Board Chairperson, Marva Canyon, and she's going to tell us a little bit about herself. Welcome, Miss Marva Canyon. Thank you so much for joining us. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you so very much for having me. I am honored to be a part of the documentary, What Happened to the King's Tree. Mm-hmm. And I think that fits so well because we can say what happened to the education in Williamsburg County School District. I remember quite well when we had top academics, top scholars, many success stories that came through the Williamsburg County School District. I am a retired educator, as my mother wasn't educated here before me. My daughter currently is employed by the Williamsburg County School District. And I have a grandson who is matriculating through the district
right
now.
Tell me what factors led to the state takeover of Williamsburg County Schools.
Okay, doctor, based on what was shared with me in March of 2018, I received a call from State Superintendent Martha Spearman, and she shared with me that she was working on a project and that she wasn't sure what was going to happen and that the last resort would be taking over a school district, which she said at that time she really didn't want to, but it was looking like she may have to. And at that time, I was working at Marsh College as the director of the teaching ed program. And she said, I wouldn't know until a little later in April whether it's going to happen or not. And she said, if it happens, would you be willing to come? I said, well, let me think about it. So we talked about it actually two times after that. And then I think, you would know this, Ms. Mack, I think it was April the 11th. There was a community meeting held here. And when the meeting was held, the decision was made that night that the State Department would come in. So I received the call that late that night from Mala that it was going to happen, and that if I could be here 7:30 that next morning. Mm-hmm. And 7:30 that next morning, I was here.
We also reached out to South Carolina State Superintendent Dr. Molly Spearman, who responded in writing to our question regarding the state's exit plan. It reads as follows. The South Carolina Department of Education and Superintendent Spearman want to ensure the district has completed all goals for improvement. Superintendent Spearman plans to begin transition of the state's control of the district on or before January 2023.
They've added on a lot. But you can see from Anderson, and it used to seem like it was a long way.
Yeah, it looked like it was forever, right?
Forever. But So to sixth grade, we attended Anderson. Mm-hmm. And then we became seventh graders.
At Thomas.
And came to Thomas. Look at these streets.
Mm. And these are rough streets, so that's why we can't hold the camera still. Okay. Because it's a rough street. And here it says Thomason Center. We can see where
the community's helping hand.
Yeah, we can see the sign is all
And then
this was the high school. The steps, this is what's left of what someone said was a Rosenwald school.
Julius Rosenwald was a multimillionaire and president of Sears Roebuck and Company, and took a special interest in the plight of black children and the deplorable condition of the schools they attended. Consequently, he created a charity, the Rosenwald Foundation, that committed large sums of money in 15 southern states for the construction of safe, comfortable schools, affectionally called Rosenwald Schools. Over the course of nearly two decades, 1917 to 1932, the foundation contributed to the construction of over 5,000 school buildings, nearly 200 teachers' homes, and five industrial high schools for black students. Ultimately, hundreds of thousands of black children received a good education in the Rosenwald schools, one of which was Thomason High School.
I like to go back. Okay. First of all, during the time that we were coming up in King Street, for black people, there were two schools. That's why this railroad track is so symbolic to me. One side of the track is one thing, and the other side of the track is the other.
And it's still that way.
And it's still that way. Actually went on that little bridge. Back then it seemed like it was so far away. And it was so big.
We could just
it's so small now.
Right.
That experience, do you remember so we're in Tomlinson.
Tomlinson High School.
And high school.
Right.
So we were there seventh grade.
Yearbook,
we were there eighth grade.
Right.
And we did ninth grade.
Right.
Did we do ninth
grade?
Yeah, we did ninth grade at Tomlinson. Right.
We did?
This is our
finish out ninth grade at Thomas?
At Thomas.
We finished out ninth grade.
Right.
Now, what I remember Mr. Green coming in to
called everybody to assembly.
In the gym.
Yeah, in the gym.
And he made this announcement that this was pretty much the end of our time at Thomason.
And that
for next school year, we would be at this brand new school that was built, and that's what we
My name is John Clark, as you said, and I grew up in King Street. And it was a fascinating experience, and overall a very pleasant experience for me. I look back with great fondness in my perspective, and those of my friends. It was sort of like Mayberry or Ozzie and Harriet and all those kind of Leave It to Beaver and those kinds of folks, and we could roam the town and just have fun among a pleasant. I was not born in King Street. I my mother was from Darlington County, my dad's from Texas, And we ended up coming to King Street in 1953. I was 9 years old. A business opportunity that had to do actually with the battle over integration, segregation, and integration. At the time, the state of South Carolina was battling in the Supreme Court to maintain segregation. And they were doing so with the on the legal concept of separate but equal schools.
Right.
And one of the problems they had in arguing before the Supreme Court, and which is one of the reasons why that the Supreme Court decision eventually became Brown versus Board of Topeka instead of Briggs versus Elliott, was because if you wanted to argue separate but equal, you had to at least try to make some argument for equal. And the state, the physical structures that African Americans went to in most of South Carolina, certainly in Williamsburg County, because I did see that firsthand as a child, were pretty abysmal. But so Governor Jimmy Burns got passed a law, what they called an equalization sales tax.
Exactly.
And the sales tax money would be used to build schools for blacks and to make them, in a physical sense, equal. So in Williamsburg County, where they were, the schools were in very poor physical shape for African Americans. There's a big building program. My dad was an architect. He came to Williamsburg County originally to design schools.
And so that's what brought you there. Uh-huh. During the time that we were talking about growing up in King Street, during the segregation. And so all of that makes sense coming together. We were at Anderson Elementary and Tomlinson High School mm-hmm. in King Street. Those were the only two black schools that were there. And so as you talked about the separate but equal, it was really separate and unequal. So the equalization tax then was to build more or better schools, improve the schools for black, for the purpose of maintaining mm-hmm. segregation.
Yeah. Remember, what do you remember about
I
that?
Was
tears
like,
and sadness?
No, you was excited at first. And then
I was confused because I was thinking, okay, he's not talking about us.
Right. Like,
That's not us. So it won't be us first. We knew about the new school being built, but we didn't really know.
We didn't really comprehend.
It didn't stick, you know?
Right.
Our parents knew, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But we just didn't. I can remember distinctly Mr. Green talking. I could see him
physically
talking and saying how we were going to act and what we were going to do and how, what he expected from us.
Uh-huh,
the thing that bring the unity there was the fact that our teachers too
were
like an extension of our parents.
That's true.
You know, because wherever they saw you, if they saw you in the grocery store, if they saw you on the street, wherever they saw you, you better behave.
Individualized attention we got in the segregated school system. We knew that the teacher loved us, cared about us, and even though there was corporal punishment back then, evidently that did not harm us at all. It's not considered abuse, of course, but
and they knew us.
And we straightened up when we saw them, you know. My show, Ineta and Friends, about your book.
Pandemic Collide in America, mm-hmm. How It Impacted Education.
They saw you as an extension of
their family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Exactly.
And so,
exactly.
You know, discipline, mm-hmm. How you spoke,
mm-hmm.
how you behaved.
Mm-hmm.
Those were mm-hmm. expectations, and especially how your academics were.
Right.
You know,
right.
You could do better,
done.
Get your work done, did you do your homework?
We had a fear of our teachers.
Yes.
You know, we had a fear. So that means we wanted to impress.
Got to.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Yes.
So let me ask you, Sandra. Okay, so that was the what I remembered, Mr. Green coming to the cafeteria, or not the cafeteria, it was the gymnasium.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And giving us that speech. And so then we're going on to the summer.
We still didn't know what's going on. It didn't click until school started.
So right. now school starts. Mm-hmm. Everybody's getting on the bus to go to this new
to
school.
The new school. Mm-hmm.
What was that? I remember an experience for me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't remember the very first day, but I remember a lot of turmoil.
Yeah, especially that first week, because we didn't have a clue what to expect.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That first week was crazy.
What do you remember about it exactly? Mm-hmm.
That first week, like when some commotion was going on in the boys' bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You don't remember that?
No.
That's where it started. That's where the conflict started.
I mean, that's what I mean. Everybody had different. Okay. Maybe you know, things were happening.
It was at during recess.
Oh, okay.
It was definitely during recess.
Black
boys and white boys.
Because I remember a fight broke out on the bus.
No, the time I'm talking about, they did it in the bathroom.
Yeah, I'm just saying there were many incidents that were happening.
Too? Yeah. Oh yeah.
It was, oh my gosh.
Yeah, I remember some others too.
There wasn't any Caucasians on my bus. We lived way out of the country.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the other side of the track.
So I remember all of this disruption on a bus that I was on. Mm-hmm. Fight broke out on the bus. I remember how scared it was because I was like, oh my God, we're going to die. You know, because the bus
and
is moving.
It started moving.
Yes, it was horrible.
But did not stop it.
I don't remember. You know how what you remember, the things you just, so it just little. Sticks in your mind. But I do remember the outbreak of a fight on the bus.
Mm-hmm.
But we had several different incidences,
on the bus.
Not just on the bus. I would remember what was considered an all-out riot at the school.
That's what I was talking about. Everyone
ended up having to go home.
Yeah.
But everything was out of control. Students were running.
They were running around. They were throwing chairs.
Yeah.
They were the
flipping
blacks
over
everything and over the desk.
And what started the riot?
I never knew what started it. A
white boy slapped a black girl.
Oh,
that's what happened.
Ooh.
A white boy slapped a black girl. And because we in school, we weren't even first period yet.
Mm-mm.
I think it was like 9, 9:30 or something. It was early in the morning. It wasn't even first period yet, but that happened on the bus.
Okay.
And the word got on the loudspeaker, and he said, all bus drivers report to your buses.
Because they were taking
us home. And I was a bus driver at the time. But the unique thing about my situation, I was a bus driver. But I was the only black on the bus, and I was the driver. My bus was completely white because my route was Boogie Bottom. Right. That was completely, so
that
I had to have like a police escort. But he didn't follow us the whole way because, I mean, it wasn't going to
right.
It was a compromise.
And then you remember when we had the court, like King and Queen homecoming.
Yeah, new hospital.
On 52.
It's gonna be a new hospital there.
Okay.
And so they say it's gonna be state of the art. I think Medical University has something to do with
They've taken over.
Yeah,
well,
they did that in Florence.
Right. Yeah, they're taking
Florence
over.
Too, right.
So maybe that's a good thing.
Good
I hope along with that comes other things.
Jobs.
We have to address the education.
Mm-hmm.
I think
jobs
a lot begins with that. If you you have to have an educated community, an educated society. We have to graduate at higher rates. We have to have kids prepared for a digital world. Now they're global. Kids are learning differently now because we know COVID has impacted everyone, but that's not an excuse because everyone had put COVID.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody had the pandemic is worldwide, so we all have had to adjust to that.
Right, exactly.
And I think, you know, based on just some of the conversations I had, I think they're on a
on a good track of trying to do that. Mm-hmm. But not only do we have to get back on track, we have to be able to sustain it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We have to be able to revolutionize the way
that
we think
was done.
Right. Yeah. Uh-huh. And so it's not like, you know, we know all the answers.
No.
I'm just saying we're trying to make
it. Right.
Asking the questions.
And I mean, I still, my legal residence is still in Williamsburg County.
My parents are still in Williamsburg.
In Williamsburg County. Yeah, that's my legal resident. You know,
my parents are still there. I have a brother that's still there. I have a nephew that's
still there. I pay taxes. I just paid taxes last week in Williamsburg County. Property taxes.
You got a vested interest.
Yeah, I have a vested interest. And you all have your mother is still there. Your parents are still there. You know, so we have a vested interest. You know, our last assembly at Tomlinson, we sang the song. We sang Diana Ross song, the Supreme song.
That was the talent show, you guys.
That was the talent show.
But that was the last assembly. That was the last
we
sang thing.
Someday
we'll be together.
Right, yes. It was me, Wendy was Diana Ross.
I was Diana Ross.
And then me and Joan McFadden were the Supreme. And then Frances Owens was the man part. She sung the bass part of the song, you know? And that was the very last assembly at Tomlinson. And that was the very last thing.
That was.
The last thing that was done. And Miss Glover, she coordinated that whole thing. She coordinated the whole thing.
What a lovely, precious dream.
Miss Glover could pull
it
out.
Sweet. Mm-hmm.
And everybody was crying. I remember there were
I
tears.
I remember crying.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
the thing.
Tears,
I,
tears,
I don't tears. Know that I remember
why
exactly.
Why?
I was
crying.
Like, I don't know.
Everybody
was
in the whole gymnasium because
that was
saying,
that was.
No, no.
I mean, Miss Glover picked the perfect song.
In a little tent since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. Say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long. But I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Yeah, those were the days. Talent shows.
Oh, yeah. Band. The best talent shows.
Songs.
The best band. Oh.
Overcoming, reaching higher, moving forward, future brighter, more and stronger, together we will see incredible things. Hey.
You heard those words?
I heard the words.
Reaching higher, moving forward, future brighter, growing stronger, together we will see incredible things. When we follow,